Welcome to Psychiatric Mini number 13, Group Therapy. So what is a group? A group is a congregation of individuals with similar interests, values, norms, and purposes. It is used as an important piece of therapy in psychiatric nursing, and we have different types of groups that we do use in the psychiatric setting. This would be things like task groups, where the patients are given a specific task that they need to complete. It can be a teaching group, where the patients are provided with education. It can be a support group, where they're provided with support and given the opportunity to express their feelings and their needs. It can be a therapeutic group, where we're working to help build meaning and elicit healing in their therapy. Or it can be a self-help group, like AA, NA, Weight Watchers, things like that. The benefit of groups is that it improves socialization. It also allows the patient to be supported. It can help them with task completion. They can build camaraderie. It gives them a way to share information. We have normative influences in groups, so that are things like helping the patient to understand that they're not alone in what they're going through. It can be empowering, and it allows for some governance for that patient. There's also 11 therapeutic factors of groups that were presented by Yalom and Lasis. And this is that groups often will instill hope. They instill universality. It's an opportunity to impart information. It can help build altruism. It can be used as corrective recapitulation of the primary family group. It can be cathartic. It can help build cohesiveness with others. It can increase interpersonal learning. It can build imitative behaviors, which is based on Bandura's modeling theory that helps patients that may not know how to dress or interact in a healthy manner look at others that are dressed and acting in healthy manners and try and imitate those behaviors. It helps with development of socialization techniques, and it can help with existential factors. So what is the purpose of that patient to them? What is their purpose on the earth? There is different processes to building a group, starting with planning a group. When planning a group, you need to determine the size of the group. Do you want a group, which is typically less than 5 to 7 people, or do you want a larger group? The size of the group is going to be fitting for different types of groups. So for example, group therapy may be more beneficial with a smaller group because individuals have more time and opportunity to talk. However, an education group may be more beneficial to have a large group because you're imparting more information to more people at the same time. You want to determine the membership and if it will be opened or closed. If it's an open group, that means that anyone can attend at any time. If it's a closed group, that means that the members that are there when they start are the same members that would be invited when it closes. You want to think of the milieu of the group. Where should the group happen? The group process should be in a setting where the patient feels safe, where it's aesthetically pleasing, and where we can maintain privacy. And then lastly, when planning, you need to decide what type of leadership style you want. There's 3 different types of leadership styles, and each one can be beneficial to different types of groups. So for example, in an autocratic leadership style, the leader primarily takes control of the process and the education, and they run the show. In a democratic group, members are equally contributive to the leader. And in a laissez-faire group, it's primarily run by the members of the group, and the leader's just there to facilitate and to answer any questions. The first phase is called the orientation phase, and this is where the group establishes rules and goals, as well as orients members to the group process. During this time, it's essential that they develop trust. The second phase is the working phase, where cohesiveness is established, and we use problem solving, decision making, and other skills to try and work towards the group goals. At this time, the leader will often transition to more of a facilitator role, and they're also responsible for monitoring member conflict. The last phase is a termination phase, and this occurs when all the goals have been completed. The individuals may regress to working phase problems because they've built such strong bonds with others that they're going to be sad about the termination. The longer the group's been going on, the harder the termination phase may be, and so it's up to the leader to make sure that they're monitoring any of that regression and helping to reiterate the progress that was made during the group and to help the patients transition to the group end. And then lastly, we have different member roles within the group. The roles may be formal, meaning they're assigned specifically to a patient, or they may be informal, meaning that the patient has assumed that role on their own. It's the leader's responsibility to help establish and monitor role function within the groups. It is generally something that's beneficial because it can help complete group goals, it can enhance the group process, and can fulfill that person's individual need, but it can also be maladaptive, especially when those resume individual role functions. So role functioning is categorized into three different categories: maintenance roles, individual roles, and task roles. In the maintenance roles, we have the compromiser, and that's the individual that is going to help mitigate any conflict or argument. We have the encourager, which is often the individual that is going to recognize others' ideas and contributions. We have the follower, who will often just sit there listening attentively to the group and is considered a passive participant. As a group leader, it's important that we try and encourage participation from the follower. We have the gatekeeper, who encourages acceptance and participation by all members of the group. And then we have the harmonizer, who minimizes tension with the group by intervening whenever there's disagreement. From the task roles, we have the coordinator, and these are individuals that help to clarify ideas and suggestions that have been made and help to foster relationships between members to help successfully meet those goals. You have the evaluator, who's frequently examining group plans and progress and adjusting that as needed. We have the elaborator, who often explains and expands the group plans and ideas. The energizer, who helps to motivate the group. The initiator, who outlines the task at hand and helps find solutions. And then the orienter, who maintains direction within the group. Like I mentioned, the individual group roles may be the more maladaptive roles, and it's things like the aggressor, who's the individual that often expresses negativity and hostility towards others. The blocker, who is resistive to group efforts or change. The dominator, who manipulates conversation, and as a leader, we would want to try and minimize the dominator. We have the help seeker, who uses the group to gain sympathy from others and aims of increasing their own self-confidence. The monopolizer would be similar to the dominator, where they're going to monopolize any conversation. We have our mute and silent patients, which are going to be similar to our followers. We have our recognition seeker, who is someone that frequently talks about their own accomplishments to try and get recognition. And then the seducer, who shares intimate details about themselves with the group that can be a distraction. And that is our mental health mini on group therapy.